Bless the Lord, O my soul, bless it.
Hi, thanks for tuning in to Armor of God. As always, thank you so much for taking the time to be here with us, and hopefully you'll be edified with what we've put together for you here. And if it isn't too much of a hassle, please do share this video on your social media to help spread the message. I mean, it's not every day that we hear priests talking like this.
So every time you sin, you get dumber. All of us do, right? Okay.
Well then, as this video is released on a Sunday, I hope it's not too late to say, don't forget to go to Mass. And then before I get on with this video, allow me to address something. A brother or sister in Christ commented on another video that I not put up any satanic images or videos in my videos. I'm sorry if some of you are disturbed by the images used in the videos. However, I have opted to go for classical paintings of the devil instead of over-the-top scary images in order to illustrate the points raised throughout the videos. I will try to search for less scary images in the future. However, please be rest assured that I am not trying to put up scary images for no reason at all. In any case, I really appreciate the feedback and I'll continue to improve from time to time. And now, going back to this video, we've been listening to a lot of Father Chad Ripperger, and one thing that I'm so grateful for is how many Protestants watching the videos here are also quite open to listening to not only Father Ripperger, but also other Catholic priests as well. And if we listen to any lectures and interviews done by Father Ripperger, we know that there are a lot of important and interesting points throughout, and that's what I intend to share in this video.
Now, you hear me bashing priests a lot. I can get away with it because I'm a priest.
Anyway, I think we'll start with this, Father Ripperger's thoughts on spiritual warfare. In this audio clip, he was addressing the subject of generational spirits, and in line with our previous two videos, I'd like to continue with that subject in this video as well.
But I tell people, spiritual warfare is like being in trench warfare. Or in, you know, you're in a foxhole. Let's use the foxhole as an example. You don't worry about what's all going on in the other guy's foxhole. You just tend to your own story, make sure that the soldiers don't come through that particular entry point, right? That's your job. Don't worry about what's going on over there. That's true in spiritual warfare. Initially, don't be worrying about everybody else. You shore your own battlefront up first, get him out of your life first, and then you can begin the process, because once you've conquered him in your life and got him out, you already have a certain authority and power over him, and you'll be more effective in helping those other people. Because if you start trying to deal with their stuff, he's just going to start retaliating against you. Okay. So one of the things, and so once you start working, the main thing to do is work on your own generational line, yourself and your children. Second, if you know for a fact that you have struggled with some type of diabolic influence, you better get your children prayed over just to make sure nothing's passed. A lot of times it isn't, but you just want to make sure that it isn't. So go to a priest, have him actually say the prayers that will help to break anything that's generational. And you have to be willing to be completely forthright with the priest and tell him this is what we're seeing. If you try and hide anything, you can say the prayers, but priests usually will pray specifically for those things against the demon's nature so that it'll help to break that. And don't feel embarrassed. Everybody's got their own generational spirits anyway. So, although you don't go around, Father, what's in your baggage? No, okay. So the priests, the rosaries, asking Our Lady to provide protection, specific devotions. If there's a specific spirit that you're struggling with, start praying to the saint that's noted for that, for the people that struggle with that. So if it's some type of demon of mental illness or whatever the case is, start praying to Saint Dymphna or whatever the case is. Find out who the nemesis is of the demon. By nemesis, we mean the patron saint that the church has set up for those specific things. So developing specific kinds of devotion. And also, obviously, to the Blessed Virgin Mary specifically, asking her to block them. Because she can block them.
And then, as the title of this video tells you, I realize there are a lot of people asking, if we really do have our guardian angels, why aren't they doing anything to help us? I actually shared the answer to this question before, answered by Father Cole. But for this clip, on the other hand, is actually Father Ripperger's recommendation about asking our guardian angels help in combating against the generational spirits.
Ask your guardian angel, or the guardian angel of your family. He knows what it is. He's dealing with the guy. He sees him. He sees what he's doing to your family. He sees what he's doing to you.
So you can ask him, okay, show me what this actually is. Now, this means, obviously, you have to have a certain devotion to your guardian angel.
Most people say, my guardian angel doesn't tell me a thing. When was the last time you talked to him? Never have. Well, there you go. Okay. So the point being is that as you work with your guardian angel a lot, they'll more likely to give you those inclinations and to do those particular things that are necessary to help you to discern this particular thing that's in your family. So you can ask your guardian angel, devotion to the saints, etc.
In every lecture or interview, one of favorite part of any of these is actually the question and answer session, because sometimes we hear some very interesting questions from the audience. For example, hear Father Ripperger answering a question, and he later shared about the spirits of death.
There was a murder-suicide by a close relative. Should we have a mass set or a priest bless the family specifically for the past sin? You want to do the reparation and things for a relationship to that. Find out if there's some type of spirit of death in the family. Find out if this is something that's been going back for a while. Because it may just not be just murder, it can be suicide. Or if there's murders throughout the course of the history, then that probably means there's some type of spirit of death. My experience is that spirits of death usually only get into the family either through, it's basically through some kind of occult activity, either because somebody in the line has gotten involved in it, or someone outside the line has caused it, although that's not an ironclad thing. What about having praying with deliverance teams, laying hands on people? It's good to pray with deliverance teams, but unless he's a priest, you don't want him praying over you. And there's a specific reason for that. To pray over it, you have to have authority in order to be able to do that. Lay people do not have authority over each other in that regard. So for them to impose hands is actually, it's a form of usurpation, where they're usurping some kind of authority they don't have. But it's also, it can be a superstitious practice in the sense that the reason a priest imposes his hands on people is because of the fact that his hands are consecrated, they're sacramentals. It's as if, you know, during exorcisms, they'll put the cross on the person's forehead or something like that. It's analogous to that. So the priest should do it. So with lay people, don't have them impose hands on you, but to pray with you or to pray for you in relationship to this stuff is a good idea and it's a good practice, as long as it's done properly.
Whenever I hear Father Ripperger saying something like this way, firmly without any hesitation tells me it's something that I must take note of and also to share with the rest of you.
God does not move us through our emotions. Let's be clear about that. What he does is, in fact, the definition of grace, the two effects of grace is that it enlightens the mind and strengthens the will. There's nothing about the emotions in there. So as soon as people, this all, by the way, came via the Protestants. This guy named Schleiermacher, who said that, he said, piety is pure emotion. So by that, after that, everybody just started paying attention to their emotions and how they felt. They thought that was God, which is obviously not the case. So when people are discerning God's will, usually they're just talking about what emotionally they want rather than what are the subtleties of God's grace. But as you meditate, the emotions quieten down, and so you're more able to see how God's enlightening your mind or inclining your will in your choice. So that, because God's grace very often, sometimes it's like St. Paul, it just whacks you and you're blind for a while. But usually it's very subtle. And until you do meditation on a regular basis, you're not going to be able to discern those subtleties. Until, by the way, you get your emotions under control, you're going to be able to discern those subtleties. Okay.
Or this one.
As an exorcist, I cannot tell you how many people have come up to me and said, I have a gift of discernment of spirits. Oh, do tell. And literally, I'm not joking when I say this. I can flip a coin and get better statistical outcome than what I'm going to get from the information from them. And the reason being is because of what? Because of the fact that a lot of times it's just based on emotion or whatever. It's not based on anything spiritual. Rarely have I found somebody who actually has it, really has it. Okay. But that all being said, we're very blind. So when it comes to solving cases of possession, I have 6 academic degrees. They have not helped me solve one single case. Every single case that's ever been solved is a specific grace is given to see what the demon's doing, what his name is, or what's going on. God has to reveal this stuff on the other side because there's so many varieties and variables that we just don't know. So guessing at it isn't helpful.
Okay. The second part of it is that tracing the roots back to the, this can sometimes be difficult if you don't know much about your lineage. Usually people can't get past much back past their grandparents. So in the case where this woman was possessed, and it was a generational spirit, it was five generations. And that it was the spirit who had to tell us how he got into the generational line. They knew nothing about the ancestor. It wasn't until this demon said something, they went back and did the research and found out that this guy was a particularly evil man.
And now for the last clip of Father Ripperger that I'd like to share with all of you is rather interesting. Firstly, it's something that Father Ripperger shared here that I didn't know before I was making this video. And secondly, this type of highlight that constantly drives me to learn more from these priests every single day about spiritual warfare.
The demons can actually, if you have a generational spirit in your life, he can move people outside of you and outside your generational line who have those same problems because he's got power over them to get into your life. That's what Deacon ends up doing. The first time I recognized this was there was a woman who was possessed by a demon of fear, and the fear, the demon used the men around her to cause her damage, to become wounded so that she'd become more fearful, so she could gain more power over her. And so that's why he drove that cycle of her going from guy to guy to guy to guy, so that she'd just keep getting wounded and more wounded. Okay. The point being is it's a demon of oppression where they move the people from the outside to cause us damage or for us to get into their life. So that's something that we need to, you need to be aware of. Just say, okay, this is a demon of oppression. This demon is going to drive these same people with these same kinds of problems to be want to be part of my life. And I have to just be very careful about it. And see, if I see that this person has a problem with alcohol, sorry, bud. I don't care how much money you got. I don't care how good looking you are. I don't care any other attribute you have. I can't be around that.
Well, then that is all for the video this time. I hope all of you have learned a lot from this video. Thank you so much for taking the time to be here with us. And if there's any feedback or suggestion, please do let me know in the comments below. I'm not sure whether a 10-minute video, 20-minute video, or 30-minute video are preferable to most of you. As I said earlier in this video, I'm still learning and I'm learning based on the feedback that I get from all of you. But in any case, for this year, I'll focus on videos that cover one single subject rather than different subjects compiled into one single video. This was a little bit too difficult in the past because there's so much I'd like to share with all of you, but at the same time, I understand that if some of you prefer one common subject in a video, such as the guardian angels or generational spirits. Anyway, for those of you who'd like to support our works, I left the link to our PayPal donation in the description box below, and from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much for your continuous support, contribution, and prayer. And until the next one, stay safe, stay healthy, and may God bless you.
Now, here's a key thing. A lot of times, priests are lazy. Now, you hear me bashing priests a lot. I can get away with it because I'm a priest. And the fact is, they are lazy and they are dumb, right? That doesn't mean you don't have an obligation of treating them with respect. It has nothing to do with their virtue. It has nothing to do with their intelligence. You treat them with respect because it has to do with their office, which is given to them and represents Jesus Christ. That's why you treat them with respect. Okay.